Okay. So let me go here, 2467. And I'm going to go into Shell Lab. I'm going to go to Shell Lab handout. And we can see we have all of these files. We have 20 trace files. Each one of these trace files is worth 2 points. So you have up to 40 points for this lab, and you work it out a trace at a time. The traces are effectively the set of instructions that are sent to a test harness that will launch your tiny shell. So the idea behind Shell Lab, as stated in the last class, but I'll just highlight it for this one, is that you're going to build your own simple tiny shell. So much of what we've been doing either in Z shell or bash or whatever you've been using as your terminal, we're going to build our own version of that, very simple version of that. And we'll see what system calls we can utilize to go ahead and manage either the built-in commands that the shell will respond to, or the ability to go ahead and fork a process, child process, and launch a external application. So all of what you've probably, many of the commands you've learned how to do inside of the shell are these small little utility applications that you can launch that does a task for you. And of course, the goal of this lab is to get you more familiar with what's happening underneath the hood of a shell so that you're much more readily equipped to use one. So, I mean, it's very rare, if ever, that you'll ever actually have to build your own shell, right? But it's a good process, a good academic process to build a tiny one so that you kind of understand what its tasks are, kind of get an, it fills in the abstraction of what's happening underneath the hood so that you have a better understanding of how to use it. Okay, so the very first trace, and let's actually launch this. Let me go back here. Let's open up a terminal. Okay, so if I could jump into here, and let's see here. So if I look at, let's say, for instance, trace one, this is the one we did last lecture. We can see that it's going to have a combination of lowercase and uppercase. Anything in the uppercase is not an instruction that's fed directly to your shell. It's going to be an instruction that the test harness is going to respond to. Any of the instructions that are in lowercase are actual instructions that your shell should be able to respond to. So for instance, we have actually an application that's given to us. It's the tiny shell reference, which is this. You can play around with this. You can launch this and you can see what behaviors the final application should have. And so all of your output, all of your behavior for your shell that you implement should mimic, it should mirror this reference application. So when you go to test and evaluate, when you go to upload your code onto Autolab, effectively all of the testing harnesses, all of the testing Autolab does is given to you so you can test it step by step. Okay, so with that said, if I wanted to test, so inside this instance, for the first one, if I type in quit, that should quit me out of the application. Let's see. And right now, when I launch our actual tiny shell, it works as well. Now, when you initially go ahead and download your Handon file, that's not going to work. The very first task you have to do is to implement that quit, which is shown in the prior lecture. And we're going to move on from that. But let's take and examine the source code so that we can recall where we last left off so that we can start implementing the next trace, trace two. So let's jump into here. Let's go into here. This is going to be the code that you're going to be responsible for implementing. And I highly encourage you all to go through and read and parse. There's a lot of comments, so it should be pretty easy to see what you have and then what you're going to have to implement. There's a collection of global variables here. which we'll talk about in just a moment. We have some function prototypes. These are the ones that you will have to implement over the course of this shell lab to actually make your shell functional. And these are going to be a collection of functions that are going to be fully implemented that you can utilize in order to, as helper functions, in order to implement the functions that you're going to need to implement. And then we have our main function here, and our main function has our, effectively, our loop, which I talked about prior. That's going to be our REBL, where we read, evaluate, process, and loop back again. And so this is where we're going to evaluate. And so really, last lecture, we went into this function, which was originally just all it did was return back control to the invoking function. And we've added these lines of code, where this first line is going to go ahead and create an empty array of the size of whatever the maximum number of args are. This second, right here, the second, and actually, why don't we consolidate this just to make it easier? So instead of declaring a variable and then assigning it, we'll just initialize it. So here we're calling this parseLine function. We pass it two parameters. One is this string that is our command line. The second is going to be the empty array that will then be populated with a set of values that's parsed from our command line. And so then this parseLine function is one of the helper functions that's given to us. So you should certainly read through it just to understand what is going to result from it. If you have any additional questions, it's actually going to give us a return value of whether the parse string is supposed to be run as a background process or as a foreground process, which our later traces is going to really challenge our shell in being able to do. And this first trace, though, we just need to quit. So we're just using a built-in command. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to invoke this other function, which is a function that's in the to implement list. So built-in command, we can give it our array of arguments, our argument vector, and it will go ahead and check to see if the command is a built-in command that our shell is going to immediately respond to. And if it's not, then we're going to have to execute some external application in response to what the command line has requested our shell to perform. So like, for instance, the built-in command that we're interested in this for this particular trace one was the quit command, which would effectively exit us out of the shell, as we saw from the reference shell. So this actually also returns back a value. It's going to return back a value on whether it's true or not that it was a built-in command. And when I say true or not, that's going to be an integer value, right? Because we're talking about C. So if it was... So we can check to see what the integer value is and determine whether we need to go ahead and continue to do more tasks in terms of responding to the command line, which we're going to do in trace two. That's what we're about to do. So let's see here. And then we have the built-in command. So we added these three lines of code. And let's see here. Let's go to... Oops. A little bit of. Okay. And then we have this function here, which was also an empty function when we first looked at it, but I just want to make sure everyone's on the same page. And so here we went ahead and we grabbed that argument vector, that argument array that was given to us, and we index and grab the very first element to see what our command was. We use the string compare function to compare our command to the string literal of quit. And if they were equal, then we're just going ahead and exit and shut down our application. And so a return value of zero represents a falsy value of, okay, that wasn't a built-in command, so we have to do something else. We have to respond in some other way. Okay, so once I have this implementation, then I can always test this. I could do my test. Whoops, I could do my, let's actually clear this. We can make test, let's do reference test. We can do the reference test on 01. And so it's going to produce some output. Anything that's in the hashtags are effectively just comments. So it's just going to echo that to the screen. If there is other actions, which we'll see in future traces, we'll see how that should print out. So effectively, we run our reference test, and then we can run our test, and we should get the same behavior. We can see we do get the same behavior, so we're done with test or trace one. Another way I could compare them is just using the diff. I do a diff, I redirect the standard in to diff with a make on the reference test one, and it requires actually two arguments. So we will also make test one. And so if we do that, we can see that the only difference between the two is going to be the instructions that actually invokes our shell driver tester. So again, this is a way of illustrating we're done with trace one. I can also just invoke this check T shell application, and it'll actually cumulatively score you. So we can see, oh yeah, we got our 2 points on our first trace, and we got our 2 points on the second trace, which, let's see here, which means that, hang on, let me go through and make sure that we also recompile in case I had a test from when I was playing around with this earlier. Okay, so let's do this again. And now I should have 2 points and hopefully now 0 points. I should not get, perfect. So I shouldn't be getting any points for phase two because I haven't implemented trace two yet. Yeah, perfect. Excellent. At this point, does anyone have any questions?